It's beautiful, it's ancient. There's really not much like it left on Earth.
We knew more about fossils dead for 65 million years than we do this creature swimming around in the oceans.
I think folks know about the spiral, they know about the shell, whether it's on their mantle, in art, or in architecture, or mathematics, but few know about the living animal.
The Save the Nautilus team is in Fiji on an expedition. We're hoping to find some Nautilus in a place that we've never found them before.
Every year we've been going somewhere else to try and protect Nautiluses, learn more about them, and share the Nautilus story.
Nautilus live really far down. They're really hard to research, but I think if we get lucky, we could find something really incredible.
I can make a square door that fits in here. Otherwise, I'll do this design. You can have one hole here, one hole here.
They live as deep as 700 meters in some locations, and 200 to 300 meters, or around 1,000 feet, is kind of the average depth of the Nautilus. It's way too deep for divers to go. So the only way for us to survey their populations is to do similar work to what fishermen do to catch them.
So you can put entry whichever way you want it, either here, on this side, or you want four, on four sides.
My name is Dr. Gregory Barord, and I'm a conservation biologist with Save the Nautilus. So the traps are a meter cubed, or 3 feet, and they're made out of steel rebar. This gives them some good rigidity, so when we toss them down 1,000 feet, they'll land and they won't break.
So tomorrow night, these will be in the water.
Tomorrow night. You can have it tomorrow night.
Each morning, we'll pull them up after they sit overnight, and we bait it with the Nautilus's favorite food, which is raw chicken necks.
They have never, as I could understand it, come up to depths that a scuba diver could safely dive. These things in Fiji probably never come up above 500 feet. These are really deep water animals. I'm Peter Ward, University of Washington, Department of Biology and Department of Earth and Space Sciences. Yeah, I got really intrigued by these creatures when I was a little boy, and I was lucky enough a long time ago, 1975, to be sent out to the far Pacific and study them. I always loved fossils, and the fossils I loved were cephalopods. And so there are so many fossil cephalopods. There's only one left that has the same shell pattern that has Nautilus. And yet, as I went through graduate school, it was clear that we know so little about the living animal.
Spin it around, eh? Yeah, this way.
When I was 11, I read an article about how the Nautilus was becoming an endangered species, and I searched for a few weeks to see if there was any charity or organization trying to protect the Nautilus, and I just found nothing. So I decided to email a professor, Dr. Ward at the University of Washington, to see what I could do to help. And he said that they needed more awareness, that a lot of people just didn't know. At that point, I decided that I was going to do something, and with my friend Ridgely Kelly, we created Save the Nautilus to help raise awareness for research and protection for this incredible species.
We're here in Fiji trying to save the Nautilus in Fiji, but also the whole Indo-Pacific. And we're trying to survey populations, but instead of just doing one method, we're using several different methods. The first method is using just simple baited traps, which fisheries and fishermen use. The other cool methods are using underwater video cameras to really look at the populations, and not just Nautilus populations, but other animals and other organisms in the deep sea. So we're trying to combine all the methods to get the kind of best picture of what they look like today.
It sits on the bottom. And it's going to put out a nice smell from that chicken in the center. And hopefully that'll attract a lot of Nautiluses. They will come through this hole and they will eat the chicken for hours and hours and hours. And then we'll pull it up tomorrow morning at about 6 a.m. or so. And some of the Nautiluses will still be in here. Some will find their way out, but hopefully enough will still be in here so we can start to look at what this population looks like.
The Nautilus dance.
Catch them, catch them, catch them, catch them, catch them, catch them.
Gotta do it.
from Savu Savu.
Hola!
So it is July 19th in Savu Savu, Fiji. This is going to be our Brub's first night, and we'll be deploying this to 300 meters, picking up tomorrow morning. Anything else to add?
We'll win and come back home alive.
All right, see you tomorrow.
Our fingers and wait till tomorrow morning to see what's in the traps and what's on the camera. As long as we get it back, that's a good thing.
What I want to do ultimately is get the word out about the Nautilus and get the Nautilus protected and researched. Even scientists don't know that much, and the general population, very few people know anything about the Nautilus.
So this is a chambered Nautilus shell, which we found at a market, and they call it the chambered Nautilus because it has a bunch of partitions, and actually this one's been broken open. Because they're mollusks, we think of snails and clams, which move slowly, or at best, don't move at all. And yet these things are jet-propelled. You can think of a squid, stick a squid body in here and have it squirt around like this, and that's what you have in this beautiful creature. The buoyancy compensator of a Nautilus are these chambers. They're filled with air, a gas, and they produce an absolute neutral buoyancy. These things don't sink, they don't float, they are just exactly weightless in the ocean.
You know, you never really know when you're out at sea in different areas. The currents are different, the reefs are different, and there's always that anticipation of, you know, what are the Nautilus going to look like? How are they going to behave? There's kind of that excitement of the unknown. It's still new every single time we do it.
90 meters.
It's only 270 feet. All right. We got to come up with bars right now.
We got a visual.
Any animals in here?
I don't see anything, huh?
Battle plans don't work. Research plans, you get out there and nature throws curveballs.
When you see nothing, it's kind of frustrating and disappointing, but from a scientific standpoint, it still is a piece of the whole picture, which is what we're trying to do down there.
Or maybe we were in just a little bit of a wrong spot. You never really know, but that's why you just gotta keep trying, and hopefully tomorrow we'll find something in the traps. But the cameras might show something different. So the bait's still on there. It looks like something was chewing on it, and should be something to see on there, and that'll help us understand more.
There were lots of creatures like this. 65 million years ago, the big asteroid came, killed the dinosaurs, but it killed off almost every creature that has shells like this. They made a small comeback, but they're extremely rare. So this sort of body plan, this evolved design of shell, is something that the world has moved past. And so we find them only in a few small places on the planet today. During the age of dinosaurs, we're pretty sure these creatures lived in daylight in fairly shallow water. Some lived in the deep water, but today they only live under darkness. So they've moved down to the very deep water areas.
We see Nautilus at 300 meters on the camera. Maybe we set our traps at 300 meters. A lot of changing, a lot of troubleshooting and learning as we go. So it's definitely taken some battle wounds over the time, some scrapes, some eaten away. So this is about 5 years old. It's been all over the Pacific. So it's done its job. This is always the moment of truth to see kind of if it recorded, what's on the camera, and if all this work was worth it. That's not very good. The battery fell off. All right, so we'll turn this on, see how much it recorded. Looks like it recorded 11 hours, so it looks like the battery fell off when we were pulling it up. Jeez. Oh, wow. And then pretty soon we'll kind of look at this and see what's on it. The important part is how we land. That's a pretty good landing. So it's kind of like landing on the moon, except having less technology to know what the bottom's gonna look like because we can't really see it. So we want that flat, sandy bottom so we can kind of see more of what's out there. Now you can see what the bottom really looks like at 300 meters in Savu Savu. Not a whole lot of anything right now. If we don't see anything, then we'll look at some other locations and see if maybe we survey those sites. Oh, there's something there. Oh, cool. So this is a deep water snapper. See, it's pretty big. Compare that to our bait stick. It's probably a good meter or so. And so, you know, you wonder, did it smell the chicken? Did it see the light? But seeing anything is a good sign that, you know, there's stuff down there. So hopefully this is just the first of other cool stuff to come. You know, we're interested in population size, but we're also looking at, you know, what's going on with sedimentation in the deep sea and what's coming from all these coastal areas and the rivers that could be impacting not just nautiluses, but the other organisms down there. And it's something that, you know, few folks, if any, are really looking at. So really, really cool. The invertebrates down here are just so incredible, and the nautilus is one of the big ones. So it's just a whole unique world. And then we have shrimp sightings that are maybe exciting the first time you see it, but when they stay there for the next 4 hours and screw up our video shot, it's not so exciting. And the shrimp, it's been an hour and it's still covering our camera. It's a really good shot of the shrimp. So we're about 6.5 hours in. There's another little amphipoda. See, now it makes it worth it, right? So all that, you know, the hour of pulling up that rope and the calluses and blisters, and they're all worth it. So there's one nautilus there coming in, and I mean, it knows where that chicken is. It's going straight for it, and it's gonna dine in on it. Some of them can spend several hours on this one chicken. Those might be the ones that maybe haven't had a meal in a long time. Yeah, this is the part of the patience kind of pays off, and that's the whole excitement of, you know, doing this science, this exploration of an area that nobody's really ever been to. So yeah, this is super awesome.
all other cephalopods are carnivores, and the thought that Nautilus must be a carnivore as well. But as we began to study them more and more, we found out, in fact, they're scavengers. We've never seen them eat live food. We think they eat dead fish on the bottom, and they certainly eat dead crustaceans. These guys have big beaks, and it looks like a parrot beak. So imagine a parrot or an eagle, and they are capable of breaking even chicken bones. But they can also break fish bones, and they're capable of cracking open crabs and lobsters. So this enormous heavy beak is this huge crunching organ for breaking up their food supplies. They swim backwards, they're jet propelled, they draw water into the shell, goes across the gills, and they blow it out with this tube. So it's really a cool evolutionary twofer. I'm breathing and moving with the same energy expenditure.
And that tentacle display is usually a display of it searching for something. So maybe it had its fill, maybe it smells something else that's putting off a better scent. Maybe it smells another nautilus that it wants to go, you know, find out if it's a male or a female, because nautiluses are solitary animals, so they don't really live in groups. So if you find a mate, then you probably want to mate when you can, because it's going to be really hard to find it again. So the nautilus is left. There's still a lot of shrimp, and it's a pretty large fish. Coming in. It looks kind of like an eel. It's got a strange snout for an eel, but it's definitely smelling our chicken. And this might have been one of the things that took out some chunks of our bait there that we saw. But we got it back. We got Nautilus, so. Yeah, and we got some other cool organisms, so yeah. No complaints on that.
So one of the things we want to study is what eats these. And we're looking at the various types of predators. And we know there are natural predators. There are a number of fish which can bite through the shell. But if we really try to categorize that predator which kills more nautilus than anything else in the world, is we humans. Humans sell the shells. It is this shell trade which is killing off nautilus more than anything else. No other predator in the world probably comes close to what we humans are doing.
The nautilus are being hunted essentially as trinkets. They're hunted in places like the Philippines for mantle decorations, really, nothing more than that. The animal isn't eaten, it's really just wasted. And because it's so delicate, even fishing a few nautilus can really have big impacts on the population. When you fish hundreds of thousands of them, or as was imported to the US a few years back, 500,000 nautilus, you can see drastic population decline. We've never studied the population here in Savu Savu before. We think this might be a good, stable population that we can compare other overfished nautilus to see what's a healthy population versus what is unhealthy. People make the mistake of thinking that all nautilus are the same, but oftentimes, especially in a place that's as far out as Fiji, you can find nautilus that are not only their subspecies, but even their own, a whole new species can be out here.
Can we see them coming up yet?
When you're pulling up a trap, you don't necessarily know if it's a nautilus, but you know it's something.
Wait, what's that in the left corner?
Or it's just a chicken. So you get it closer and closer and closer, and we have all these eyes looking at the trap. No, you know, it's exciting.
Oh, yeah, there's one. I see one.
Yay! Good job.
Looks like two nautilus. Two of the first nautilus from Savu Savu that anybody's ever seen alive. So really exciting moment. I'm jumping it right now to take him out of the trap. We'll hand him up. We'll record some measurements, take photos, and then get them back in there.
We we can't keep them long in our world. The water temperature at the surface is so warm it kills them. So we bring them up, we put them in refrigerated water, we spend a few minutes with them.
Here we go. Second ever Savu Nautilus after this guy.
Okay, so you want to grow your hands?
When we catch them, we take a tiny little bit of their flesh and we can get all the information about DNA and their genetics. I take a little tiny bit of shell the size of a sand grain.
3 millimeter black layer. So here we're going to have its diameter.
Our modern instruments are so powerful that if I take a tiny bit of this calcareous shell, I can tell you its history of eating. I can tell you the temperature it grew at. Is it a carnivore scavenger? All that stuff from these tiny little bits of shell.
Male.
We photograph it, we get all the measurements. You don't need to kill them.
All right, see you, Greg.
Both of those animals were really old.
We're looking at 25-year-old animals,
at least. But I think some of these are 100 years old. They don't die. I mean, they can get killed, but there's no genetic mechanism for aging that we know of. And that's unlike any other cephalopod. And all the rest grow fast, live fast, die quickly. And Nautilus is the opposite. It grows slowly, lives a long time.
We caught two Nautiluses, which is really, really good. We're able to take measurements, we're able to determine their sex, we're able to learn more about the population here in Savu that no one else has ever learned about.
Dave, it was a good day, very good day. Yes, we did.
We need to increase sample size, so we'll go out a few more days, and we only have two DNA samples. We want to get that up to about 10 or so. We'll run the DNA, we'll see how similar or dissimilar are these from New Caledonia, from Samoa, from Vanuatu, from this entire section of the Pacific.
This is the first time I've seen them in 5 years since American Samoa, and it was really cool to just look into the eyes again of this ancient creature. You know, it was like seeing them for the first time all over again for me. Really, they're just so out of this world, a relic of 500 million years. So I could really see that when I looked at them. It was really exciting.
We've seen them on the cameras. We've seen them in the traps in person. So now we're ready to do it again and again and again the next few days and get a good picture of this population here.
Not a lot of people know that this is an endangered species.
I think there's something down in the bottom right
corner. So that's why we're spreading the word about this incredible animal and the dangers it faces.
They don't become sexually mature until 10, 12, 15 years. When they do become mature, they reproduce and they lay up to 10 eggs. They take a year to hatch. So it's a thing that's really important for conservation. It's just you can't continually fish them and expect them to kind of replenish stocks quickly. They're more like an elephant, like a large mammal in that sense.
Look how tiny this guy is. 132, mature.
It's really a small reproductive rate. And they're right on the knife edge of extinction.
1 millimeter black band. This is the littlest Nautilus I've ever seen in Fiji. What a tiny little midget.
We've already documented complete extinction of what appeared to be a genetically unique group in the Philippines. This is a population that, should people start trying to get the shells, could be fished out of existence really quickly.
All right, let's put this guy back in the water, and we're done.
This is our last day in Savu. We're gonna go out there today and pick up our trap and our bruvs. I'm hoping to see one or two Nautilus in the trap and maybe some more Nautilus on the bruvs, but I think it'll be a good day just if we can get both those traps back.
Looks like it's still alive.
As we keep putting down our traps and our cameras, we learn more and more. Down in the very deep water where these are found, in some places on Earth, they're fairly abundant. we're finding in Fiji. They're extremely rare.
All right, so how many?
Four.
Four?
How many?
We had a three, we had a four.
One.
I said one yesterday.
Two.
Two. Zero.
I said one.
Might be one.
What's the bait?
Oh, yeah, there's one. I see one. Bright and clear. I don't know if I see a second one yet.
Yeah, we're getting one per trap, where we can quite often get a dozen in other places. And their tiny size tells us they're just on the edge of existence here. Say this goes extinct. What are the unintended consequences? There might be some octopus out there which only eats nautilus. So you kill this, you kill it. There are other creatures which eat nautilus, or that nautilus also consumes or affects in some way. I mean, any ecosystem is a house of cards. You keep knocking out cards, it's all going to collapse.
Very interesting.
He isn't even mature, so I think this is something entirely different.
Josiah, put your finger on it. There we go. Friendship.
This particular nautilus is the smallest of its kind we've ever seen. I mean, we've caught baby nautilus that weren't fully grown, but this thing's fully grown. So nowhere in the world have we seen a living animal this small. So this is a new dwarf population. It might be a new species. It's new to science.
Okay. If we continue to engage folks in what this animal is, what it means to the ecosystem, and what it means to the planet, that'll get folks more interested in wanting to care about conservation and nautiluses, but also, you know, the entire ocean and the entire planet in general.
There's still more research that will always make protection efforts stronger. The more research we have to prove that this species really needs protection, the more protection it will get. We still have a lot of work to do, so I don't see myself stopping anytime soon.
In my lifetime, they've gone from this creature, which was very mysterious and we thought to be very abundant, to less mysterious, but way more close to extinction than anybody thought. We don't need this to sit in our bathroom as this beautiful trophy. We don't need it to sit in some bowl that gets dusty and finally goes out to a garage sale. We need to have one of these cultural changes, behavioral changes, that until they happen, we think will never happen. If we are going to have a diverse world with such beautiful creatures in it, so there's so much left to do.
Hi, everyone. My name is Alexa Elliott. I am the series producer for Changing Seas at South Florida PBS. We're very excited to be co-hosting today's event with the Ocean Media Institute and Save the Nautilus. Joining me today are the producer of the film, Dr. Gianna Savoie. Gianna is the director of the Ocean Media Institute, as well as the director of filmmaking for the Center for Science Communication at the University of Otago in New Zealand. Hi there. Also, we have with us all the experts featured in the film. They are the world's foremost expert on nautilus, paleontologist Dr. Peter Ward from the University of Washington, Save the Nautilus conservation biologist Dr. Gregory Barord, who's also a marine biology instructor at Central Campus Regional Academy in Des Moines, Iowa, and then the founder of Save the Nautilus, Josiah Utsch. So welcome, everybody. Thanks
great
so much for
you.
Joining
Thank
us
you.
Tonight.
Thank you.
I know we're in time zones all over the world, from New Zealand to the entire breadth of the United States, so that's fun. Just a quick heads up for those of you watching. If you have any questions for our experts, please go ahead and just type them in the comment box beneath the screening, and we will answer those as quickly as possible. But first, to kind of get started, tell us a little bit how you guys all connected and how you, you know, what led up to the making of this awesome film.
I could start with that. Hi, everyone. I'm Gianna. We were really, really excited about all the work that Save the Nautilus was doing. I had known about this organization for a few years, and they contacted us at Ocean Media Institute to produce a little 5-minute film about what they were doing. They had mentioned they were going down to Fiji to work and to try to find this possibly to explore this new area where they hadn't found Nautilus before, but had suspicions that they might be there. So they raised some money and invited us to come along. And the goal was really to make a little 5-minute promo piece. But then we had so much great material with them, and the Brubs footage, the footage that you see in the films that Greg got from the cameras was so great that we decided we could do way more with this. So it ended up evolving into a much longer film. And yeah, very excited.
And it's super information. I mean, I learned so much just watching it. It was really fun. I was really curious, you know, building those traps. How easy is it to actually catch the Nautilus in a trap? Is that very challenging, or did you guys get super lucky because the cameras were there?
Well,
I might start that, Greg. Go ahead, Greg.
I was just going to say, Peter, Dr. Ward would be the perfect person to start with this question.
The answer, unfortunately, is way too easy to catch them. They are like so many deep sea animals. There are very few of them down there, but they're exquisitely evolved to find bait. And so many of the deep fish that we are really fishing out, I remember what we used to call Chilean sea bass, which was the Patagonian toothfish, same sort of deal. These things are so superbly evolved to find meat down there that they can come many kilometers following. They're like bloodhounds following the least scent track, and they will find the traps. But the problem with that is it appears that there's so many down there. Everywhere across the Pacific, locals believe Nautilus are very, very common, when in fact there's very few of them, but very easy to catch.
And I know you've done this same type of research in other places in the Pacific. We actually have some video to show some more of this really cool underwater footage. Can you guys, as we play the video, maybe tell us a little bit about where you were at the time, and did you always use chicken necks for bait?
Yeah, sure. And to answer the first question, chicken is the most common thing we use. So This video is from Australia, one of our very first trips, and it's a little bit of different setup, but in the little red bait bag is our raw chicken necks. And this was a unique video because you see in the back the little tiny nautilus, which we don't really see young nautiluses often. So in order to see, you know, something that's maybe 3 or 4 years old is just really helpful when we try to understand these nautilus populations overall. This takes us to an island in the Northern Pacific in Palau, and these nautiluses are just chowing down, and you see a large shark in the back. It seems like such a very good shot, but we're not even sure what type of shark that is. So some of these videos can be so compelling, yet so frustrating because we can't go back to them and really see what's going on. This video here was from Papua New Guinea from 2015, where we recorded some of the first video of the fuzzy nautilus. So this weird looking nautilus here that we had thought had maybe just disappeared. And we were able to record it just doing what nautiluses do. So in this case, this nautilus is chowing down on tuna. And we're back to Australia here. So we have a large grouper up to the right, top right of the screen, just kind of, you know, looking at the nautilus. And, you know, you have to imagine we're looking at this for the first time. And its buddy pops in and tries to eat the nautilus. And so you can see the defensive mechanism of nautilus to close up quickly in its shell. And I think this is a great video from the Philippines, because the Philippines is an area where the nautiluses are fished most. And this is what we saw, one nautilus here and there, if any. But you can see so many other organisms down there as well. Here we are back in Fiji from the expedition from this documentary. And again, you see the nautilus there, but the more we look at the nautilus, the more we're starting to look at everything else down there, all the different invertebrates, all these, you know, seemingly odd crabs to us, but there's a world down there that we're just beginning to kind of unlock and put all these different pieces together. This nautilus here is back to the chicken bait. I wish trips like this were easy to travel. Now we're already back to Australia. And this, we have more little invertebrates, but I really like this shot because that little cockroach looking thing down there is an isopod. It's another kind of old animal who's been around. But just kind of like I said, you know, when you see nautiluses, you see the whole ecosystem. And so it's not just the nautilus is impacted by fishing or by anything else. It's everything else down there. And we're just trying to really start looking into this nautilus ecosystem.
Which is such a so fun, not to just see the nautilus themselves, but all these other creatures. Whitney actually is curious what the coolest non-nautilus creature is that you've ever caught in a trap.
I'll start. I maybe not caught in a trap, but I think the most unique thing we've seen on some of our underwater video footage was a seven-armed octopus. And it's called a seven-armed octopus because one of its arms is just a little smaller. So it has eight arms and one kind of tiny one. But just to see that gelatinous kind of ooze of stuff down there was a neat thing.
And Greg, speaking of octopus, it's one of the things that we never saw that may be the most exciting and frightening. We have one video where the camera is pointed toward where the nautiluses are, and then the entire video screen goes black from octopus or cephalopod ink. But it's not just a little bit of ink. Something huge came up behind the cameras and then inked the entire sequence. I mean, you want to talk about the Kraken. This thing, there was some huge cephalopod down there. We'd love to know what it is or what it was.
Wow, that's wild. Are any of the animals ever bothered by the light? I mean, since they're living in such a dark environment, it doesn't look like they are, but is there any evidence that might affect their behaviors at all?
Great. Well, with the lights, it's certainly a bias. It's our one bias that we do everywhere we go. So everywhere we go, we have to have these bright lights so we can make out what's down there and, more importantly, identify nautiluses individually based on the stripes. So certainly if the lights were on them for, you know, maybe several days, several months, they might have some kind of impact, but the nautiluses are free to go when we do the underwater camera. So if they are, you know, continuing to eat that yummy raw chicken and the light is too much of a negative stressor on them, you know, they can easily jet away. So it's hard to say what type of behaviors or what types of things the lights may impact, but we just have to use them.
Yeah, definitely. Actually, Paula is curious, why chicken? How did you figure out that would be something they would just absolutely love to munch on?
Well, chicken is interesting. The first people to really study nautilus goes back to British explorers way back in the 1890s. And someone named Arthur Willie went out and spent 2 years of his life in very primitive conditions. And he use many types of bait, but I think chicken smell goes out further into the water than almost anything else. So perhaps they can detect an even smaller amount of the molecules from chicken than virtually anything else. Certainly, if you've ever had rotten chicken around, you know that stink is awful. Well, lots of stuff thinks rotten chicken might be the greatest perfume on earth because they certainly track into it.
That's funny. And you mentioned when we were watching the video, you talked about some of the other locations where you guys do your field work. Can you tell us a little bit more about that? Like, are there certain parts of the Pacific where nautiluses are more abundant than other places? Or are there places you still haven't gone yet where you'd like to go do some research?
Josiah, tell us about Samoa. You were there.
Yeah, so the farthest east that I believe we've ever researched nautilus, the farthest east trip I've ever been on was a expedition to American Samoa, which is very far east in their range. It's one of the last island chains in the Pacific when they kind of start getting less and less frequent. And there were not as many nautilus there. And it was one of the first times they'd actually ever been recorded in American Samoas when we went there. So that was really exciting, going into a place, as in Savu Savu, that was entirely new to nautilus research. And we didn't catch a ton of them there, but I think that makes sense considering that it's not in the middle of their range.
Yeah, well said.
And actually, I know we heard a little bit about it in the film, but tell us more about what made you want to start this foundation and get involved.
So as I talk about a little bit in the film, when I was 11, I read an article in the New York Times about how this incredible animal, the nautilus, was going extinct. And it had always been one of my favorite animals. I thought it was just incredible that it was this living fossil, this dinosaur that was still alive. And then I was just crestfallen by the idea that we were losing it. It was like we had an opportunity to see ancient history before us, and we were just throwing it away in this tiny span, in this tiny time frame. So I started Save the Nautilus, which is the charity I run. Peter helped me get off the ground right at the beginning. I emailed him and asked what I could do, and he really set me on my course. That was almost 10 years ago now. It's just been an incredible experience. And I think I've noticed that it's really just a problem of people don't know about the nautilus's plight. The more people know about it, they really connect with the beautiful animal. People just don't know that it's not, people don't know what it is. People don't know that it's this incredible endangered species that represents so much.
And you bring up a really important point there. It's like, how big of a problem is the shell trade? I mean, I know you guys talked about it in the film. Is that somewhat regulated now? Are there CITES protections that protect the species from being, you know, shipped from one country to another? Or is it just running rampant still?
That's a great question. We certainly know that many places now across the Pacific are trying to regulate the trade, at least in nautilus. But what about all the other seashells? What about, we go in any curio store in the world, and you can find lots and lots and lots of shells. The problem is we are so vertebrate-ocentric. You know, we worry about bears and grizzlies and all the various kinds of animals that look like us. But there's been very little concern about invertebrates. And what I'm hoping SaveTheNautilus.com does is morph more into Save the Mollusks or SaveTheSeashells.com. We don't need to decorate our houses with these things. There are so many of the beautiful shells that are really rare, and yet very little effort goes into saving invertebrates. South Florida, you have large warehouses where shells from all over the world accumulate. And you walk into these places, and they are giant morgues. They're homes of the dead. There are places where we are killing creatures for our vanity.
And if I could add on
one
to
thing
that.
Sorry. Just one anecdote.
Sorry. One little anecdote I'd like to share about kind of how crazy the Nautilus trade is that I've been in national parks in the United States, and in the hotel bathroom, there was a Nautilus inlaid on a toilet seat. And I even was watching a documentary the other day about salmon fisheries, and there was this really vocal environmentalist, and right behind her on her library shelf were three Nautilus shells. I was just blown away. Like, even fisheries scientists are not tuned in to the massive danger that these animals face. It's just really, it's really crazy.
Yeah, and so with, you know, you asked about the CITES regulation. So it's one of our goals of a lot of this work was to, you know, not just regulate, but figure out if regulations are necessary. Because I think when you think about animals declining or organisms declining, you want to just regulate, but without good data, regulations are not worth anything. So it took years and years to compile enough data to present to CITES organization, which is the Convention on Endangered Species, Convention on the International Trade in Endangered Species. I got it. And what they do is they regulate the trade between countries. So they aren't necessarily regulating the fishing practices. So in one hand, it's a very good step in the right direction for Nautilus conservation to have the trade of Nautilus shells or Nautilus pieces or even living Nautiluses regulated now. And so we can kind of keep track of what's going on. But that does nothing at the local level of, if you were to travel to an area where there are fishing Nautiluses, you could buy them legally. There's no problem with that. But it would just be, you know, getting that shell or that jewelry item outside of the country. So regulation is one part. It's a very big part in one hand, but when you look at, you know, what you need to do after regulation with education and awareness and education and awareness again and again, that's what's really going to protect Nautiluses and, you know, other seashells, other mollusks, and really the ocean in the long run.
And I know earlier today you shared some pretty interesting statistics that talk about how much the local fishermen in some of these countries make for catching one of these Nautiluses versus what they're selling for. So it really doesn't, it sounds to me like there really is also a disconnect between what the people on the ground make versus then what some retailer is profiting off of it. Is that also one of the issues?
Yeah, I think so. And I think you probably see that kind of chain in anything, really. The person catching the fish or the person, you know, making the item is probably getting the smallest amount. But when you think about a fishery like Nautiluses, where it is really, it kind of is a fossil, not a fossil fuel, but it's a fossil resource because they just can't reproduce quick enough to replenish their stock. So Dr. Andy Dunstan, who has done a lot of Nautilus work in Australia, he kind of came up with the term Nautilus mining, because when you're fishing for Nautiluses, you're really just mining them until they're gone. And, you know, the traders, the people at the top can kind of move to different areas and hire new fishermen. But, you know, the fishermen who do depend on the Nautilus shell trade for their families, for resources, they're kind of lost. So there's no real winner in here in all of this. And I think the documentary shows that pretty well.
Are there any efforts underway in any of these countries to maybe provide an alternate source of livelihood, or are there even some countries that have outright outlawed the fishing for the Nautilus?
Greg, that's you.
Okay. Yeah. So ironically, many countries have regulations in place to either not catch Nautiluses, so not fish for them, or not sell them. But it goes back to just anything. It goes back to enforcement. And Beyond enforcement, it goes back to engagement. It's just kind of like any law or regulation. I mean, how do folks really learn to abide by that? Well, they learn to abide by that. They over time, they understand, okay, you know, this isn't good. I can't do this. So in a strange sense, there's been laws on the books in many countries to not fish them, yet they just haven't been enforced.
Yeah. Are there any?
There's a real danger right now. And for years, eBay was really the scariest thing for this. You couldn't go on eBay right now and just punch in Nautilus shell, and you could still get them really cheaply. So there's clearly a supply that's happening. But an even greater problem to me is that there are several of the species. Nautilus is one of the two that are out there. The second one you saw a movie of, the fuzzy Nautilus, its name is Allonautilus, or the other Nautilus. These are far more rare even than the already rare Nautilus themselves. You have to spend about $200 per shell on eBay to get one of these. So these were the animals we were studying in Papua New Guinea. You asked earlier, where do you want to go back to? Well, that's where we want to go back to, because these are really endangered. And unfortunately, there is still this great desire by people in their shell collecting to get these. The per capita income of the local fishermen there is very low, but even there, these things are worth big money. And so it's really a race of survival for trying to get the market to quit buying them, because that's really how you're going to change this. So you have to change the entire mindset. You don't need a shell on your bathroom dresser. It's just, it is killing species.
Yeah, and you know, we actually had a couple of viewers ask if there's any way to tell how many Nautilus are still out in the wild, or is that really too difficult to determine?
Oh, it's very, we can make estimates, and Greg is the senior author of a paper where we did just that. We came up with a pretty good estimate of how many there are over any, say, square kilometer of bottom, and even in the best of circumstances, not very many. But in places like the Philippines where we've worked, where they are fished, they are virtually gone in some places. And in fact, we found one island in the Philippines that had its own genetically distinct population that was last seen in about 1900. That's an extinction of an entirely separate genetic group, gone. And this is what is happening increasingly across the range of this. So yes, it's a big problem.
And what are some of the other methods that you use to study them in addition to the baited camera traps?
Well, one of the things that we've done, this is the hardest work of all, and we did not do this in Fiji, but one of our major means of studying them is we attach battery-sized transmitters under their shell. Tracking is well known. People study sharks doing this, birds, all kinds. We were among the very first. I was the first to actually put on these tiny transmitters on the Nautilus shells. And these can last for up to 2 weeks. They tell us every second, they give us a depth and a position and a water temperature. And because the Nautilus never seemed to stop swimming, we have to sit over them in small boats for day in, day out, for week after week. But these data are fantastic. They're telling us what the daily movement of one of these is, where they go, how they live. And this is among the most interesting of studies and what we would like to do going forward.
And that brings up a perfect viewer question. A couple of people have asked how they forward propel themselves and how their movement occurs.
Greg, that's you.
So Nautilus, just like other cephalopods, octopus, squid, and cuttlefish, have a funnel that they use for jet propulsion. And the Nautilus isn't a fused funnel like an octopus. It's more like if you think of, you have a paper in your hand and you kind of fold it together. That's kind of the Nautilus's way to move. And so it's able to pump water on the side of its shell. I'm pretending I'm a Nautilus now. And then it squirts it out this funnel called a hyponome. And the unique thing about nautiluses is that they can move in any different direction. For the most part, they're moving shell first. I mean, if that's your defense, that's your shield mechanism, you're going to be having less drag. You're going to be moving shell first. And it looks like from a lot of the video we've seen from underwater is that when they get close to that bait, they just flip around. And then those tentacles come out and they're just searching for anything. And when they find that something, in this case, it's a chicken neck or tuna, in some places they latch on and they just chow down for hours.
And actually, speaking of their feeding mechanisms, I know we have another video we can show that you were able to film. Can you kind of describe, I guess they have a beak, right? And then how they utilize that beak to eat their prey?
Yeah, so this is a nautilus that is in the lab. This isn't from the field. And what's happening right now is the nautilus hasn't picked up the scent of this shrimp yet. You can kind of see its tentacles starting to move. It's starting to say, okay, raw shrimp, so much better than chicken. Thank you. And as we're getting closer and closer to it, it's going to open the tentacles up more and more. And I think you can kind of see in this shot that the tentacles can be protracted and retracted depending on what it's doing. And in the middle of these dozens of tentacles, there's a very powerful beak. Inside that beak, there is a radula, which is a tongue with spikes on it, which help to grind down that food so that that food can then pass through the esophagus and then be digested. And it's relatively quick, I mean, depending on what you're feeding them, but it's, you know, it's kind of a scary sight to think about if there were still 10-foot nautiloids around to be taken in by their tentacles, and you just see this huge kind of chomping beak and this chainsaw tongue in the middle, and it works perfect for the nautilus.
Sounds like something of a horror film, envisioning a 10-foot one. what is, a couple of people are curious, what's their role in the ecosystem? Are they mostly predator or more so prey or somewhere in the middle?
Peter?
Well, they seem to be scavengers. I mean, everything we can see, again, we've not seen live predation. When you get them in the trap, we have lots of shrimp generally in there with them. Once they can corner a shrimp in the corner of a trap, but in nature itself, we've done gut contents way back in the day when I used to catch them live capture in shallow waters by hand. And these were sacrificed and everything in their gut was turned out to be pieces of shrimp and crustacean. But interestingly enough, we never found meat in them, mostly material that they find on the bottom. They're very good at breaking down the exoskeletons of crustaceans. They are so low energy. These things are capable of living in very deep cold water. They don't need much energy to do it. And so they don't need a bunch of food. So they are getting any sort of dead material on the bottom that they can find. They're also good at living in very low oxygen. In the Philippines, some of the deepest water has much lower oxygen than at the surface. Nautiluses can dive down there. If you have a place that has low oxygen on the deep bottom, other scavengers won't go down there. So these guys are like, they have their own little diving bell where they don't need to breathe much. They dive down to a place where no other animal can actually respire, get the carrion. And once again, if you're on a low oxygen bottom, stuff never rots. You can have material sitting, dead fish sitting down on these deep bottoms for days and days at a time. The nautiluses can go down and get them and come back up to the shallower areas where they get oxygen and breathe again. So it's a beautiful scavenging body plan.
And in terms of, like, a couple of people are curious, having seen especially the clip of the one in captivity, is it possible to farm nautilus? Could you maybe replenish a population that way, or is that not really feasible?
Greg?
Well, it's certainly possible, but I don't think it's feasible. And if you just think about, you know, maybe any business plan, if you know you're going to invest a lot at the start, and then once you have all these nautiluses together, you are going to have to wait for them to mate. We don't really understand, you know, the cues on nautilus mating. And so let's say you get all that right. So you have males and females and they're mating. Then the eggs are laid. And again, at least based on studies in aquariums, they can lay up to 10 eggs at a time. And I should mention that we don't know where they lay the eggs in the wild. So it's another kind of big mystery of where are all these hatchling nautilus. So you're in an aquarium, you have eggs, you're really excited, and the eggs take a year to hatch. And when they hatch out, they're about the size of a dime, or maybe an inch or so in diameter. Very, very tiny. So if you're thinking about it from, you know, can you just dump those nautiluses back in the ocean that small? Probably not. So you grow them up to be maybe adult size, which could be up to 10 years, and then they're back. This is all under very, very complex aquarium chilled aquariums. You need to have really good water quality for them in captivity. And it's just not something that, at least now, that we figured out an easy way to do.
Like to add on top of that, no one has raised, maybe Greg, you can speak to this, but the last time I was aware, no one has ever raised a nautilus to maturity, to sexual maturity. People have barely been able to raise them past a few months.
Yeah, that would be key in figuring that part out. Gianna, in terms of filming this research and the animals themselves, what were some of the biggest challenges you guys faced? Looks like we lost Gianna. We'll come back to that. The rest of you guys, tell us a little bit more about discovering the
things. So there were a lot of unknowns as far as what to expect. So that was probably the biggest challenge, was, you know, just kind of keeping up with what was happening and making it interesting. And just following these guys around, and you know, we weren't sure weren't able to dive not so deep. So having the grubs set up, we knew was going to be a great little way of
I think you're cutting out a little bit, but we do have some follow-up questions actually about the kinds of cameras that you, and this is probably for both of you guys, the film crew as well as the researchers, like the kinds of housings you use. Could you use infrared light instead of regular light, or I guess some sort of a red light instead? Like, you know, they have to be, I'm sure, depth rated fairly well to withstand the pressures of the depths that you're going to. Tell us a little more about that.
Well, the cases themselves were made by a company in Australia, and they're not cheap. And so it's always a tragedy when we lose a set, and we've lost a few sets. We have right now a set sitting in Vanuatu, a set sitting in Palau, a set sitting in Papua New Guinea. Let's see, just about every trip we seem to lose one of these, and they're about $10,000 when you lose it. So that's tragic. The lights themselves, we've tried different colors, and it doesn't seem to affect anything that's down there. So infrared would be interesting, but I don't think the light source would be powerful enough for us to really get much of an image. And don't forget, we have to try to identify the stuff we see. So it's already challenging to come up with the name of a species of fish or crustacean just from the films themselves. But again, someone asked earlier about the light, you know, what is the behavior going on in the light? And that wonderful film where you saw the big grouper coming up and trying to take a bite out of that Nautilus, I doubt that would have happened if that light had not been there. Grouper are visual animals. And in the deep sea, it's so dark, it's very doubtful that there would be a grouper that size able to see these Nautilus and actually get them. So that might have been an artifact of our using those bright lights.
Oh, interesting. That's wild. And do you mind repeating, because we had a couple of questions, repeating again the depths that they live at? I know it was part of the film, but just to kind of, for the people who are tuning in late.
Well, there's two places on Earth where, as a scuba diver, you can see them. And I've been both of these places. Right now, as we are doing this live, my invertebrate paleontology class is tuned in, and their TA, Mr. Job Veloso, who arrived in America 1 week ago from the Philippines, a new grad student, a new PhD student at the University of Washington. But Job and I, in late 2014, dived with wild Nautilus in Vanuatu in about 30 feet of water. I've dived with them in New Caledonia down to 120 feet at night, always in the dark. But most of the places, they're way deeper. Those two places have cool enough water. It's all about water temperature. The Nautilus come up shallow water. Everywhere else, 300 feet is about the minimum depth of them. And they can go down as deep as 800 meters or 2,400 feet. So no divers are going down there to see them. And the other aspect is that they're just, again, few and far between. If you put bait out, you might get a chance to see them. But the places where we have been able to see them in the wild, interestingly enough, in New Caledonia, most of the Nautilus are coming up after lobster molts. So they're coming up into the 20, 30 foot depths, getting the molts of big spiny lobster there, grabbing them and swimming back down again. It's a spectacular sight.
Yeah, how cool would that be to get to dive with them as well? One question we had is there a way for you guys to tell whether a Nautilus is a male or a female?
Yeah, it's pretty easy.
Yes.
You have to look inside the shell, though.
Does that harm the animal at all?
As far as we can tell, no. And interestingly enough, the transmitter work doesn't harm the animal either. We put on these small transmitters, the batteries last a couple of weeks, but there's no way we ever recapture them. So they are living with these transmitters on their back. And it was thought maybe this is going to kill them quickly. But in the Philippine Islands where we ran this, 6 months after we tagged them, the Filipino fishermen were catching the same animals alive in their traps. And they can't really cranky with us because any animal they catch, they kill immediately and keep the shell. And they were cranky that they had these darn battery things on the shell. They couldn't sell them. So the good news, bad news. The bad news for the Nautilus in the Philippines is there's such heavy, heavy pressure to catch them that most animals are going to get caught sooner or later. But the good news, at least for we scientists, is the transmitters don't seem to hurt them in the least.
That's good. Actually, speaking of hurting them, one person was curious if it hurts them when you take that tiny piece of shell, the sample that you use for genetics.
It's not hurting them when I hit the shell because that is obviously has no nerves in it. We also take a tiny little bit of their flesh, one of their 90 tentacles. How much nerve there is when you snip that off, I don't know. I don't think it's much. We've never seen any reaction. There's no pain reaction to it. We know that when these tentacles get snipped off, they probably can grow back, such as an octopus can. So again, we are not killing any of these things. It's just there's been enough killing going on from everybody else, and that's not our job.
Is ocean acidification a threat to them as well? That was another viewer question, and maybe whomever answers this, if you could just give a brief explanation of what ocean acidification is for some of our viewers who may not know.
Greg, I'm going to pass. I did an hour and a half lecture right before we got on live, so my throat's gone.
Okay. So ocean acidification is one of these big things that, you know, a lot of folks are looking at is what's going on in the ocean. And so it's kind of a huge term to describe the more that the ocean becomes acidic. So it's lowering in its pH, and it's doing that from number of different reasons of why there's more carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, and ocean acidification could impact organisms that use calcium carbonate to grow their shell. And I think with Nautilus right now, we just don't know enough about them to know how it could impact them positively or negatively.
I might add to that that I live in the Pacific Northwest. The trouble with ocean acidification is that the more carbon dioxide there is in the atmosphere, the more acidic the ocean gets. But it's not constant in terms of temperature. Colder water gets more acidic than warmer water. And the good news for Nautilus that at least are in the shallow waters, the warm water doesn't get very acidic. They're fine. But Nautilus are living down at least 100 meters, and we're catching them at water temperatures of 16, 15, 12 degrees centigrade, so the 40, 50 degree Fahrenheit. The water up here where I live now is so acidic that oysters, newly born oysters, their shell is literally dissolving off their back. And we're faced with the prospect in the Pacific Northwest of losing all native oysters because they could no longer reproduce. I'm a paleontologist. We have studied what has happened in the deep past. The nearest analog we have to what our atmosphere is doing now happened back in the Permian period, 250 million years ago, where volcanoes released so much carbon dioxide into the atmosphere that the oceans became extremely acidic, so acidic that invertebrates could no longer successfully reproduce. And those with the tiny planktonic calcareous shells had their shells dissolved right off their backs. We are seeing that right now in the northern oceans in small mollusks called pteropods. They are literally dying off. And these are important in the food chain to birds. So yes, we are seeing a global catastrophe from excess CO2 going in the atmosphere.
Yeah, that's always, gosh. And you combine that then with the human catch, it's just a scary thought. Gianna, that kind of brings me to a question for you. I know as filmmakers, for us, that's always a big challenge. And how do we tell these stories and bring them to a wider audience? What was your hope for this film? And what was the main message you were hoping to get across?
Well, the whole hope for this film was honestly to get it out in the exact way we're doing it today, to bring it to a big audience and let people actually have a conversation around the Nautilus, because they are such a mysterious animal. And we like to do that with all the projects that we take on. They're really about getting the stories out there about, we love to tell stories about things that may not be getting a lot of press in other areas too, maybe not the big charismatic megafauna kind of way. So this is a wonderful way of doing that, and something that Ocean Media Institute really tries to do a lot.
Yeah,
I'm actually, breaking up a lot.
No, I think you're okay right now. We actually had a follow-up question too about the Ocean Media Institute. Can you tell us a little bit more about the mission and what you guys do?
Sure. Yeah, well, our whole mission is actually to expand the public's understanding and appreciation of ocean science and conservation through innovative visual media. And what we do is really work with other organizations and scientists and other universities and institutions to collaboratively make these projects happen, and to find out what exactly, if someone is coming to us like the Save the Nautilus are organization just did and asked us to make a film. We work with them to figure out what exactly they want to do with it and how they, you know, how they want to shape a story. And then we work with them in ways to get that story out there to a broader audience. So everything that we do, we don't take sole ownership of in any way. We are all about open distribution. So we certainly get it out there and do the festival circuit and try to get it out there to as many eyeballs as we can. And we also give it right back to the organization to do exactly what they want to do with it. And we try to just keep it really openly accessed so other scientists or other students or other communicators could also take advantage and use it in any way they want. So it's really about just getting the science in interesting ways out there to folks and getting them excited about all this ocean stuff.
Which worked out perfectly for us because we were super excited that we were able to show this program because it also fits with our mission so well. And it's, you know, perfect for the, you know, I think there's a lot of synergy. So it's always great to get the word out to as many people as possible. We also had a couple of questions about the size of the Nautiluses. What are the largest Nautilus you guys have ever seen?
The biggest ever recorded that live today come from Western Australia, Port Hedland. This is a place way up in the northern side of Australia where very, very few people live. And these are about 250 as much as 300 millimeters. So these are big, big creatures. But the Nautilus we just saw from Suva, from Fiji, from this film, seem to be about the world's smallest. There's one smaller species present on a tiny little reef off the Philippines. It's way out in the middle of the ocean on an area called the Tubataha Reef, a World Heritage Site that has the tiniest of all. And these are, again, fully adult at about 5 or 6 inches. No, maybe less, maybe 3 or 4 inches. But if you go back in the geological past, for the coiled shell types, you go back to the Cretaceous, and there we had creatures called ammonites that were up to about 8 or 9 feet in shell diameter. And for nautiloids, some of the straight ones way back even in older times, in the Paleozoic, 300 million, 400 million years ago, their shells were like long tubes, 10 to 12 feet in length. These were really big time monsters. And so we had these things as very large in the past. So the size we have today is pretty small compared to the biggest there ever were.
And one question that came up a couple of times is, does bringing them up from the deep cause any issues for them? Well, I'm assuming not because you guys do it, but like in terms of the pressure change and how it is okay to release them without having to take them back down to depth.
Yeah, that's a great question. And we were years and years ago, we were much worried about this. But then a number of studies in the 80s and 90s and 2000s where scientists brought up Nautiluses, put tags on them or marked them and put them back down very quickly, and then caught them year after year after year after that, it shows that they have no effect. Turns out that the air in their chambers is almost at a vacuum size. It's really low pressure. So when you bring them all the way up from 300 meters, which would be 30 atmospheres of pressure down there, the expansion that happens when, say, you bring up a fish, which has a swim bladder, and a deep water fish brought quickly to the surface dies because its swim bladder expands and bloats and pops out its throat, doesn't happen to a Nautilus. They are slow moving physiologically, going up and down, doesn't hurt them at all. What can hurt them is bringing them up into warm water and not having cooled water waiting for them. And this is why the tourist trade in Palau, for instance, where tourists are, they're trapped, they're brought up to the surface, tourists get to swim around with them in the 75 to 85 degree surface water. This may be killing a lot of Nautilus. So this is really the wrong thing to do.
And someone was that kind of along those lines was asking if it's hurting them to be out, or I guess actually they're asking how long can they stay out of the water without being hurt?
Yeah, they're ideal animals, experimental animals for that regard. You could have a Nautilus out of the water for as long as a half hour and pop it back in, and it just pops its head out and starts swimming around. And the reason for that is they have a very slow physiology. Again, they're living in the slow lane. They do very little work. They've got a physiology that is dealing with very cold, low oxygen water. And so they do fine out of water. This is why we can put on these transmitters, but we still have to keep them cool. But as long as you don't overheat them, they don't seem to be bothered by not being able to respire for as long as a half hour. Greg, that's your sense too, isn't it?
Yeah, and you know, for most of the things that we're doing with the Nautilus is on the boat, it's, you know, you could kind of see from the video is they're in the water, they get into the chilled seawater on the boat, and then they're pretty much back in the water within 5 minutes after we've measured them and taken photographs and processed them, they're released. So when we have them, you know, we don't want to bring them back to the shore for any reason. We do everything on the boat, and getting them back home is our main goal once we catch them.
But I want to reiterate one of the things that one of your viewers did ask about taking them back down. And that kind of is one of the scariest part of all of this. There have been numerous occasions where we are swimming them back down, because if you just let them go in the shallow water, they are in that warm water. So generally what we do with scuba is we take them back down to about 100 feet because we get them in the cool water fast. Way more than not, what comes up at you out of that deep water, because we are over very deep water, are sharks, big sharks, lots of different kinds of sharks. I don't know how they do it, but you've got sharks way down below you. They hear the ruckus and they come up. And there are a number of cases where I think animals that we are trying to bring back down, as we see them descend way down into that 1,000-foot bottom way below you, you can see sharks hitting them. It's almost like kicking a soccer ball. You see the little white things just dropping down into the blackness, and there's that shark bouncing it off its nose, trying to break open a shell. So yes, that is the danger.
Wow, interesting. I hadn't even thought of that. We have a few more viewer questions. I just want to take a quick second to thank our generous funders that make events like tonight's Changing Seas Live possible. And they're the Bachelor Foundation, which has been with us for the last 13 years. And also a gift made in loving memory of David G. Perot from the Perot Family Endowment for Environmental Education. So thank you so much for supporting public television. One other question that has come up quite a bit, especially as we were preparing for this program, is what is the plural of Nautilus? And also, what is a group of Nautiluses, I guess, called?
Yes, Nautiluses. And a group of Nautilus, we've never really seen them in groups. I don't think there's an actual name for that, other than that would be when we see them feeding at bait. You know, they come into a group, but I don't know what the group for Nautilus is called.
I would call
that's,
it exciting.
That's something we can work on in the future.
So in terms of research, what's next for the research? What's on the horizon for you guys?
Well, depends on funding, of which at the moment we have none. So there's nothing on the horizon for us. There's hopes, but at the moment there's not a concrete plan.
I mean, I think the thing that you see when we went out to Savu, something that you can see there is just, this is a place we had never, no one had ever researched Nautilus before, as far as I'm aware. You know, this is a completely newly researched island. And we go down there and instantly we see Nautilus. And there's so many thousands upon thousands of islands in this range. There could be just vast amounts of species we haven't discovered yet. So, I mean, there's really limitless possibility for further Nautilus research. And if you want to donate and want to help contribute to Nautilus research and Nautilus conservation in the future, you can check out SaveTheNautilus.com. or SaveTheNautilus.org, And we have more information on the website, so check us out.
Yeah, I was actually just going to share a question from a viewer who was curious what people can do to help and how they can help get the word out. So that was perfect. Gianna, what about the Ocean Media Institute? What's next for you guys?
Well, we're just finishing a film about a community on St. Paul Island, which is a tiny little island up in the Bering Sea. The Anungan community up there is really facing a huge issue with marine debris. And it's also home to the world's largest fur seal, northern fur seal population on which the Anungan depend. So it's become a real problem for them. And so we went up there and worked with them to create this film together. And we're just finishing up the edit right now and hope to get it out in a few months. And that was funded by a National Geographic grant. So we're really looking forward to releasing that and to getting folks interested in knowing more about what's happening up there and getting some eyes on that issue as well.
And what would be the best place for people to learn more about Ocean Media Institute and you know, some of the cool projects that are in the pipeline?
Yeah, come on over to oceanmediainstitute.org. We've got a whole list of all our initiatives and all the kinds of things we're working on. And you can see more of our films and other projects that we've worked on. So yeah, oceanmediainstitute.org. And you can follow us on Facebook and Instagram as well.
And I think that's the same for Save the Nautilus, right? For research?
Yeah, you can follow us on Facebook and Instagram as well. And the Nautilus Files also, Greg does a really good job. We have so much awesome footage, honestly. That's something I like to do when I'm just bored, is I just go onto Greg's videos and just scroll through Nautilus footage, sharks, mola mola. There's so many cool, there's so many cool things we've seen.
And this is on YouTube, right? The footage you're talking about?
Yeah, and it's on Facebook. I guess Greg can talk about that.
Yeah, so if you search for The Secret Life of Nautilus, which I think is a really good title for it, on YouTube, that's where we have a lot of our kind of highlights of the Brubs footage, because what you all don't really see are the hours that we look at this stuff, and there's either nothing there, or there is the same thing there. So we try and get the highlights out there, but also on the other social media stuff, if you just search Save the Nautilus, you're gonna find us somehow.
Hey, awesome. Greg, what was awesome. Your worst moment on any of these trips? What one moment out there were you more afraid than otherwise? Because a lot of these trips are also terror.
So I guess the, I don't know if I would say terror, but the moment that sticks out is, you know, just something as simple as we've done in a lot of different places. We pull the trap up and the old bait goes back into the ocean, and then we rebait the trap. And we usually do this, we set traps around dusk, or not dusk, sunset. And around that time, the sun's going down, things are changing, and being in the water with chum and having your research partner Peter on the boat taking pictures with our crew as sharks are circling around is one of the moments that sticks out into my mind.
You notice I'm in the boat, you're in the water. See, this is smart. And my worst was the Philippines, where we were tracking Nautilus using tiny little dugout canoes in the middle of a typhoon, and the Philippine guy whose boat it was, I looked at him and I said, "We're okay, aren't we?" And he's shaking his head, "No, no." That was no fun. Because you always did the 3 a.m., so you were much tougher than me, so I had it easy.
I think what Peter's getting at there too is that it's really wild out in a lot of these places. Like, these are not always, I mean, I've only been on like the most, tourist friendly Nautilus expeditions, if you want to call them that. And this, it's not in places that are geared towards tourism. It is like really wild out there. I mean, I remember in American Samoa, we used basically a wooden boat, and we took that, they took the wooden boat out to like just thousands of feet of open ocean with big waves. You know, it's not, it's definitely exciting.
All in the name of science, huh? I think as filmmakers, we can relate to that, being in crazy situations. We actually have one person asking, what's your favorite experience with the animals?
I'll start. So my favorite experience now is when we were tracking Nautiluses in the Philippines. And, you know, as Peter said, I usually took the late night longer shift, and you're out in a little dugout boat for up to 12 or 16 hours. And one day we were just overnight, the sun's coming up, and Joe, the fisherman that we worked with there, taps me on the back of my shoulder, and he'd made coffee. And so we're just sitting there, there's silence all around. All you hear is the little ping of the Nautilus transmitter on our receiver, and the sun's coming up, and you're so tired, but just those little things of, I didn't even know he brought coffee on board the boat or how he made it. But just sharing coffee with Joe that morning was just really special.
For me, I actually, the year after Gianna filmed the Savoie Savoie documentary, I went back to Fiji, and we went to a different island with a much greater count of Nautilus. And some of the days there were just, it was amazing how many Nautilus were in the traps. I think one day we caught 16 Nautilus in one trap, and then there were like two more traps with 10 Nautilus. And it's really exciting atmosphere. It's almost like you're working in a, I don't know how to describe it, but we're really trying to get these Nautilus churned out and turned into the water as soon as possible. So you just have these big groups. We had a lot of people, and it was just tagging Nautilus, measuring them, put another one in the water. Like Greg's burping them. There was a shark that came up, and then Greg's back in the boat. And it's just really exciting. And it was so exciting to see so many Nautilus and to just kind of work one after the other. That's always remember that.
That's awesome. What about you, Peter?
Oh, there's too many memories. I've gotten too old, so I'll pass.
Do you have a favorite memory from filming?
I think my memory of that was your poor husband, Gianna, and dealing with the huge ocean day and how you guys persevered through that. That was amazing.
Oh, we had a blast. Well, except for the time when we were filming, there was one point where we were, my husband was a cinematographer, and we had pulled up, it was right when they finally caught one of the Nautilus, and they were, you know, measuring it and everything, and they had it in a little bucket. And my husband is, you know, staring through the viewfinder and watching this little Nautilus kind of swim around in circles and circles. And all of a sudden he just threw the camera at me and raced to the back. And I'm sure he's going to love me sharing this story. that was my one moment of actual cinematography skills and working that out. But honestly, like the mornings, I love the mornings. I'm a morning person anyway, but getting up early and getting on that boat and just watching the sunrise as we're heading out to sea. And then, you know, the anticipation of what that day could bring. And again, you know, there's so much in filmmaking, especially documentary and especially wildlife documentary filmmaking, that there are so many unknowns and things that you just cannot anticipate. So it's that constant, like, what will happen? Will we find them? Will we not? Well, you know, how do we, you know, trying to figure out the story in your head as you're going for every scenario that might unfold. And it was just wonderful. And that moment when they did, you know, see them in the trap was really just exhilarating for me. And again, I had never seen a live Nautilus up close, so it was super wonderful because I'm a total ocean geek, and just it was fabulous. So loved it.
Yeah, it sounds like an awesome experience. If people would like to see live Nautilus, are there any places where they are in captivity where people can, you know, admire them without, you know, buying the shell, but actually seeing the living animal?
So currently, at least in the United States, I'm only aware of Monterey Bay Aquarium that's exhibiting them. And there may be some other aquariums. There's definitely other aquariums in other countries. But in the United States, I'm not sure of any other ones.
I'm wondering if there are any in New Zealand. Do you know, Gianna?
That is a really good question. I don't know. There aren't many. I think there's only one aquarium. Do you know, Peter?
Well, Auckland has one of the most beautiful aquariums in the world, as you know. That's a spectacular aquarium in Auckland. But when I was there last, no Nautilus, and they didn't have any desire, I think, at that point to have them. And to be frank, I just think it's an animal that if you put them in aquaria, it's going to really reduce their lifespan. These are animals that aren't supposed to live at the surface. They're living when they live at very shallow pressures, over, even in cool water. It's a death sentence. So I'm not a big fan. I love the idea that we learn a lot about animals seeing them in aquaria. But there are just certain animals I think it's probably not the best. For instance, we up here in the Northwest for years had killer whales up here. And that was one of those things that is probably not the best in the world. Secondly, I'm in a classroom in Seattle, and my janitorial staff has given me the high sign. I have to get out of this room so they can sterilize it. I mean, we are in the world of COVID. So I'd like to be able to sign off and thank you all for hosting this, and what an amazing movie.
Yeah, thank you guys so very much. It was a real pleasure meeting you all, and thanks so much for participating tonight and being part of our chat and sharing the movie with us. For those of you watching at home, if you'd like to find out about our upcoming events, go ahead and log on to our website, changingseas.tv, and click on the events tab. And we will update that as soon as more information becomes available. And thank you so much for watching. Have a great day or a great night, depending on where you are.
Thank you so much.